Hello and good morning, St Mary's. I'm Steph, I'm the curate here, and a very warm welcome whether this is the first time or the 100th time. If you haven't watched us before, we sing worship together in the service, we say a confession and a creed, we see a little clip from our 0 to 18s team, we have a reading, some prayers, and we hear the word of God. And this week we hear it from Graham Morris. But before we begin to worship, I'm going to pray. So Heavenly Father, as we come into a time of worship, may you settle our hearts and our minds to focus on you for this next hour, that we may be filled by your Spirit here today. Amen.
To praise the wonders of your mind. and I love you, Lord.
Oh, to know the power of your risen life, and to know you in your sufferings,
to become like you in your death.
Hello, and thank you, worship team. It's so good to be able to sing still, isn't it? Even though we can't sing in church at the moment, it's so good to be able to sing worship in our homes. We are now going to come to this point in our service where we say our confession and our creed. Our confession is a point to say sorry to God for all that we've done wrong this past week. We don't always have the words to say it, but these words help us to say sorry and our slate wiped clean. So joining with me with the words on the screen. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. And may Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring you his pardon and peace, now and forever. Amen. We are now going to say what it is that we believe. What it is that we believe in Jesus Christ. What it is that our faith is in. So say this loud and say this clear and say this with meaning. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried and he was raised to life on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received and this we believe. Amen. You probably have seen that the 0-18 teams have been quite busy recently preparing for their holiday club. You'll have seen that Claude's been up to lots of things. I do really encourage you, if you have got young people in your house, to watch the Holiday Club. It's brilliant. I found some of the challenges really hard. You'll see Harry and I in there were being filmed, doing some stuff, and I just couldn't do some of it. I also, when I was asked to do the filming, they didn't really prepare me for what was going to happen. I'd have worn the right gear, I'd have stretched better. I rocked up, I came dutifully, asked to be filmed, and yeah, but it was loads of fun, and it's loads of fun to have a go at home. The videos are great. I watched one yesterday because I actually went round to go and help Claude film for this week. Harry and I went round and to go and see him. He's such a nice guy. You're all going to love him when you get to meet him. And I just helped him, and Harry and I helped him think about Stephen and the reading this week. So I'm going to hand over now to Claude to see what we were up to the other day. And then we'll hand over to the Farrells, to Kat for the prayers, and then to Fiona for our reading, then Graham for our sermon. So take care and God bless.
Hi Claude.
Hi Rachel.
How are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
You look very well.
Something really cool happened.
Yeah, week. Tell me about it.
I bought a new car.
Wow, off did you Peter really Elliot. Buy it?
It was off Peter Elliott.
What is it?
It's a red, like me, Audi.
It is. It looks amazing.
You love it.
I absolutely love it. Do you love it?
I do. I was wondering if I could FaceTime you this week to talk to you about the Bible story for this week.
I'd love that.
I'm a bit confused by it, but I've got a few questions that you might be able to answer.
I absolutely would love to.
Thank you, Rachel.
No worries. Enjoy riding in your car.
Thanks. I'm going to go now.
Okay. See you soon.
Bye.
Bye.
Hi, Rachel.
Hi, Claude.
How are you today?
I'm really well, thanks. How are you?
I'm good. It was so nice to see you yesterday.
It was lovely to see you too.
Did you like my car?
I loved your car. Did you? Looked like you're having lots of fun.
I was having so much fun.
Yeah.
Oh, and lovely to see Mr. Peter Elliott and Mr. Dex. That was nice.
I think your bandit's Dr. Elliott.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, we had so much fun, didn't we?
We had a lovely time.
Okay, now down to business.
Okay.
This week's passage, Rachel, is all about Stephen. Do you know much about Stephen?
Well, we spoke about him a little bit last time, didn't we? Because he was one of those seven people chosen to help distribute food.
Yes, I remember. But I've been reading a little bit further in the passage, and actually he was a pretty incredible man.
Yeah, amazing. Tell me more.
Apparently, he was full of God's grace and power. And you'll never guess what. When he preached, people really listened to him. Yes. Something else that I learned is that he laid everything on the line for Jesus. And guess what? Even his life.
Wow.
I know. We should all try and be a bit more like Stephen, shouldn't we?
Yeah, I think you're right.
He also did all sorts of things like speaking with wisdom, healing the sick and performing miracles. But he never made it all about him. He always made it about Jesus.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to learn a little bit more about the story and then I might get back to you later. I've got my friend Steph and Harry coming around. They're going to talk to me about it as well.
Oh, brilliant. That'll be nice. Give them my love.
I will. So, yeah, I'll let you know what I've learned at the end of the day, okay?
Looking forward to it.
Have
you
a
too.
Lovely day.
You too. Lots of love. Bye.
Bye. Hi, Harry and Steph.
Hi, Claude.
How are you?
We're all right.
You're
all right.
Okay. Are you doing all right?
Yeah, yeah.
We're both doing all right.
It's really nice to have you here in my kitchen.
Oh, it's so nice to be here.
So, this week, guys, the story is about Stephen. Do you know anything about Stephen?
Only a bit, not that much.
Stephen is a man full of God's grace and power. And guess what, Steph? When he preached, people listened.
Wow. They don't always listen when I preach.
I do.
That's good to hear.
Stephen laid everything on the line for Jesus, even his life. We've got to this point where the Sanhedrin, do you remember them, Steph?
Yeah, yeah.
They are really, really mad at Stephen because all he's doing is talking about
Jesus.
That's
Jesus.
The correct answer. Well done. So what I thought we would do is we'll go through the story and I'll explain it to you. And because you're such good drawers, maybe you could draw some pictures for us as we go along.
Absolutely, yeah? Really, I'd love to.
What Stephen did was this really, really long speech, but it was amazing. Now, Many Israelites at the time didn't believe that Jesus was really the Son of God and that he was God's rescuer. So, Stephen told stories to remind the Sanhedrin, they're the naughty people, aren't they? That God built his family through Abraham and Moses. Do you think you could draw me some pictures of them?
Bagsy's gonna draw Moses.
Thank you.
Like I'm doing Abraham.
Maybe at home you could draw Moses and Abraham as well. Or maybe just Jesus. Or maybe me. Okay, Steph, show me yours.
Here's Abraham.
Oh, wow. It's brilliant.
Thank you.
Stephen did this big speech. And what he said was, if they ignored the truth that Jesus was the rescuer, then they would be disobeying God. Now, when he'd finished speaking, you'll never guess what happened, guys.
What happened?
He looked up to heaven and saw Jesus stood by God in heaven. I like to think that God and Jesus gave Stephen a really big thumbs up. What do you think? Because God loves it when we share his story, doesn't he, Steph?
He does, yeah.
Okay, so let's get back to the story. So the Sanhedrin were really, really mad and they gnashed their teeth and they yelled at him and then they dragged him out of the city. Have you been drawing your mad faces?
Mad?
Oh, he looks really mad. Can you get that on film? Ugh. So they were yelling at Stephen because they were really cross with him. And they dragged him out. And you'll never guess what they did, guys. They picked up really heavy stones. And they threw them at him. And died. The story is all about how Stephen lived and died telling people about Jesus. Don't you think we should be like Stephen?
Absolutely.
Yes. Okay, so let me give you a quick version of what happened next. News of his death spread. Followers from across the Roman Empire were inspired. And guess what?
What?
God's family got bigger!
Wow!
And spread God's rescue plan further than it ever had before. Don't you think that's amazing?
It's incredible.
Yeah, really, really cool.
Yeah, I think so. Okay guys, how do you think we can be like Stephen today?
Well, I think it would be really cool if we just were unashamed of our faith, actually, and just were like him and that.
Yeah, because he told loads of people about Jesus. Do you like telling people about Jesus, Steph?
I really love telling people about Jesus.
What about you, Harry?
I think the one thing we see Stephen do is he tells people about Jesus, no matter how they're going to respond. You know, I think he probably knew before he told the Sanhedrin they were going to be a bit mad about it, but he still told them anyway. And I think that's something we've always got to be willing to tell people, regardless of how they're going to respond.
That's really good, Harry. Thank you for that.
You take that back to Rachel.
I'm definitely going to, because she's going to ask me what we learned today, and I need to be able to tell her something. So it's really lovely to have you here, and we're really going to miss you guys.
Oh, we're going to miss you.
Bye!
Often when we pray with our children and young people, we use the teaspoon method. Thank you, sorry, please. Today I thought I'd use the chat method. Prayer is all about talking to God, and if you ever struggle knowing what to pray, then just think chat. The C is confession, a chance for us to say sorry to God. So let's pray. Father God, we come to you knowing that you love us unconditionally, that you are a God who forgives. Sorry for the times this week where we have not lived the way you would have wanted us to. For the things that we have done that we shouldn't, and for the things that we should have done but didn't do. For the words spoken that haven't been kind, for the thoughts that weren't noble and true. Father God, please forgive us. Thank you that you're a God of second chances and fresh starts. The H is for honour, a chance for us to praise God, to recognise who it is that we're talking to. So Father God, we recognise that you're all-knowing, that there is nothing that takes you by surprise. God, you are all-loving. You love everyone, no matter who they are or what they've done. God, you are all powerful. You are the champion, our great big God. and you are good, and you're gentle and kind, and we love you. The A is for ask. So today, Father, we ask for your help. We think of the world and we see the mess and pain and confusion, and we ask for your help, for your mercy, for your hope. We pray for our brothers and sisters all over the world, and we pray for our mission links and partners and their families in Portugal, Spain, DRC, Gambia, Malawi, Senegal, Zimbabwe, and the UK. And this week we pray particularly for Richard Harrison, who teaches at Falcon College in Zimbabwe. We pray that you would give him all he needs to serve you. Encourage him, strengthen him. May he know your presence this week. Lord, give him a real sense of your closeness. And we pray for our community here, for those struggling, for those that are sad, who are worried, those that are lonely. Father, give them your peace. We pray for those who are unwell. We pray for Anna Drysdale, Peter Halliwell, Peter Harris, Will Allen, Peter and Eleanor's son-in-law, James Wilson, Mike and Val's son-in-law, Paul McAleese, Brian Mather, Beryl Morris, Peter Jenkinson, Ray Sanderson, and Nathan Jers. Lord, be with them and all who love and care for them. We pray for those who are suffering the pain of loss. Father, bind up broken hearts. Bring comfort and peace to the family and friends of Morris Burrows, Jean Pepper, Barbara Barker, for all those who are affected by the loss of someone they love. The T is for thanks. Thank you, Father, for one another. We thank you that we belong to you. Thank you that there is no age limit on being part of your team. Thank you that you've given us all gifts and skills to serve you. And thank you that you will show us how best to use them for the praise of your name. Thank you that you're always with us. And thank you that as we begin a new week, you go before us. And thank you that when we talk to you, you listen. Amen. And of course, Jesus taught the disciples a great way to pray as well, the Lord's Prayer. So let's say that together now. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
Acts chapter 7, verses 55 to chapter 8, verse 25. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. At this they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he fell asleep, and Saul approved of their killing him. The church persecuted and scattered. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea, Samaria. godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him, but still began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. Philip in Samaria. Those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went. Philip went down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah there. When the crowds heard Philip and saw the signs he performed, they all paid close attention to what he had said. For with shrieks, impure spirits came out of many, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was great joy in that city. Now for some time, a man named Simon had practiced sorcery in the city and amazed all the people of Samaria. He boasted that he was someone great, and all the people, both high and low, gave him their attention and exclaimed, "This man is rightly called the great power of God." They followed him because he had amazed them for such a long time with his sorcery. But when they believed Philip, as he proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself believed and was baptized, and he followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles he saw. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to Samaria. When they arrived, they prayed for the new believers there, that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come on any of them. They had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on him, and they received the Holy Spirit. When Simon saw the Spirit was given at the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money and said, "Give me also this ability, that everyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." Peter answered, "May your money perish with you, because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry, because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness, and pray to the Lord in the hope that he may forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin." Then Simon answered, "Pray to the Lord for me, so that nothing that you have said might happen to me." After they had further proclaimed the word of the Lord and testified about Jesus, Peter and John returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel in many Samaritan villages. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning. My name is Graham Morris, and I'm a reader in training here at St Mary's Upton. I want us to think today about some incredible good news, that our Heavenly Father, in his infinite grace, will forgive every one of us who truly repents, everyone who can say sorry for what they have done and mean it, that we are forgiven, not by any good works that we have done or by being good Christians. We are forgiven simply because God loves us all. Before we look at today's Bible reading, I'd like us to start with a short prayer. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for sending your word with power over the years, thereby making this church a green pasture where the saints are well nourished and established. Let your sent word continue to go forth from this church, resulting in healings and deliverances in all of our services all throughout this year. Amen. How do you feel about magicians? I'm of an age to remember one on TV called David Nixon, but you'd probably be in your 60s or older to remember him. I suppose the modern day equivalent would be somebody like David Blaine or Dynamo. I was never a great fan, if I'm totally honest. I suppose I knew it was all trickery or sleight of hand. But if you go back a few hundred years, there were people then who believed that this magic was real. And we've heard about one such famous magician already today, Simon, in our reading. Today's Bible reading is really in two parts, and that's the way we're going to have a look at it. We've got that story of how Stephen was killed and the early Christians were persecuted and that church scattered. And then Luke's narrative leaps quite suddenly away from Jerusalem to Philip in Samaria. We start our reading with the early church being persecuted. We have Stephen, the first Christian martyr, killed for saying that Jesus was standing at the right hand of God. Well, blasphemy to the Jews who covered their ears. And then we hear for the first time of this young man, Saul. It says in chapter 8, verse 1, when they stoned Stephen to death, it says, "And Saul approved of their killing him." And then we hear of his great persecution that broke out against the church in Jerusalem. And all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. In verse 3 it says, "Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison." So what do we know about this young Pharisee, this Saul of Tarsus? Well, we know he was a devout Jew based in the city of Tarsus in Galatia. He's one of the largest trade centres on the Mediterranean coast, and it was renowned for its university. We know very little about Saul's early background. Later in the book of Acts, it quotes him referring to his family by saying he was a Pharisee born of Pharisees. He confesses that prior to his call, he persecuted beyond measure that early Christian church. We know that few people seem to like him when they first meet him. He can seem angry, pompous, bossy, overbearing, and yes, always right. And yet when people got to know him, there was a recognition that he was a very intelligent young man with one of the most creative minds in history. But all of that's for another week. Let's look today at that second part of our Bible reading. We've heard that the Christians were being persecuted by Saul and the other Pharisees in Jerusalem. And so they head off into Judea and Samaria. And in verse 8 we can read that Philip went down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah there. Well, it's there we hear about this man, Simon the sorcerer, Simon the magician. In verse 9 it says, "He amazed all the people of Samaria with his sorcery." And then we read in verse 13, that Simon himself believed and was baptized. He followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles that he saw. Now, although this is quite a well-known story, I don't think I'd ever noticed before I started to prepare for today that it said he believed and was baptized. Well, then the apostles heard about all the success Philip was having, and Peter and John followed him into Samaria, and we read that they placed their hands on the new believers and they received the Holy Spirit. Well, Simon thought this was a great trick and he offered to pay to find out how it was being done. We read that Peter was furious with him and says, "May your money perish with you because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money." repent of this wickedness. Pray to the Lord in the hope that he may forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. Now, to be fair to Simon, he answered Peter by saying, pray to the Lord for me, so that nothing you have said may happen to me. Over the years, Simon the magician, Simon the sorcerer, has had a bit of a bad press in the early church. But I want us to think this morning about that response from Simon. Pray to the Lord for me. Pray to the Lord for me. Simon believed and was baptized, we know, by Philip. Okay, he got it wrong, asking can he buy the trick that he thought was being done by Peter and John. But which one of us has never got it wrong? So what are we to take away from this reading? What is it that we can learn for our lives today from the story of Simon the magician? Well, firstly, even though he was a believer and he'd been baptized a Christian, he still could get things wrong. He badly misunderstood what Peter and Paul were actually doing. Or perhaps more importantly, he wanted to use this thing that he thought was a trick to use it himself and to make money out of it. And that was what so upset Peter. This morning, I want us to think about Simon and what might have happened next. Because the thing that stands out to me in our reading was that I think he repented. That line, pray to the Lord for me. Pray to the Lord for me. The lesson from today's reading is not about how he got it so spectacularly wrong, which we all do sometimes in our lives, but that I think he repented. He asked that he should be forgiven. And that's what I want us to think a little bit more about this morning. We will, all of us, get things wrong sometimes in our lives. Well, perhaps not so spectacularly wrong as Simon did that morning, admittedly. But each one of us is a sinner. Nobody is perfect. Other than Jesus himself, no one has ever been on earth that is without sin. We all get it wrong, in thought, word or deed at some time. Well, that's why we have our prayers of confession every week in church. What really matters is that we can come to God and say sorry and ask for his forgiveness, that we truly repent. Forgiveness that we don't earn or deserve. Forgiveness that is given freely by God's grace to everyone who asks, including all of those who get things spectacularly wrong in their lives, like Simon the sorcerer. What we don't get from our Bible reading today is what happened to Simon, the hopefully ex-sorcerer. Luke finishes off the story by saying that after they'd further proclaimed the word of the Lord and testified about Jesus, Peter and John returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel in many Samaritan villages. But what about Simon? What happened to him? It leaves us to think about what Jesus would have done with Simon. To try and answer that, we can look back into the Gospel of Luke. For what did Jesus himself teach? When he was walking along the Emmaus Road, we read that he told them, this is what is written, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And in verse 47 it says, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. So if Simon did truly repent of what he had done, I am sure that Jesus would have forgiven him, as he'll truly forgive us too if we repent. And that's the thought I want us to take from this passage. In this one reading, we have salvation moving out from being just for the Jewish nation, beginning in Jerusalem with a church being scattered across Judea and Samaria. We meet the young Saul, the Pharisee, who would go on to become Saint Paul, apostle to the Gentiles. And then we have our story of Simon the sorcerer, Simon the magician, who got it so badly wrong. What a lot to take from one passage. But what would I ask to take from all of that? Well, it's actually that promise from Luke chapter 24, verse 47, where it says, repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations. Repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations. In today's reading, we see that first it went out from Jerusalem, out from Judea and Samaria, and then on to the whole world, including to us here today. And that if we truly repent, then through the grace of our Lord and Saviour, we will be saved. And that was the good news I want to share with you this morning, that God in his infinite grace will forgive every one of us who truly repents. Everyone who can honestly say sorry for what they have done and mean it. That we are forgiven of our sins, not by any good works that we have done or by being good Christians. We are forgiven simply because God loves us all, simply by God's grace. Our slate is wiped clean. And so what happened to Simon, the ex-sorcerer? Well, in truth, we don't know. Luke never recorded whether he went back to his old ways or whether that encounter with Peter and Paul that day made any difference to his life. But that reading can make a difference to us. If you choose, you can turn your back on things that displease God. And that is what the word repentance actually means. You can turn your life around and turn towards God today. But not in your own strength, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so in the same way that Simon the sorcerer asks Peter to pray to the Lord for me, I'm going to pray for us all now. A prayer that our lives may be turned around, our lives may be transformed through the love of our Heavenly Father. And so let us pray. As we take our worship, praise and prayer from this place and out into our daily lives, may our lives be turned around through the love of our Heavenly Father. May we feel the presence of our Saviour walking beside us and know the power of the Holy Spirit in both our actions and our words this week. Amen.
To would prevail. Satisfied, he will hold me fast.